so here we are again. Let's just listen to them again, full speed ahead. Let's do it again. Okay, so there we are. So he's ending on the third string with his arpeggio, and then he takes that note and he takes it to the number three box on the fourth string, and that would be a 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2. That would be the 2. So there it is right there, the 2. He's going from the 6 to the 2. There's the 2. He starts off in the 6. And then he starts his ascension run on that 2 in the number 3 box on the 4th string. That would be a bop finger position right there for all you that are wondering. This is 2. This is 3, and the pinky is 4, and then he's using it to go up like this. Taking it all the way up. You take it down the neck, an octave, it would look like this.
Thank you.
2, that's right. So the 6 to the 2. Ah, it's G2. Okay. So I'm going from D6 to G2. That would be the famous Miracle Man by Zach Wild. Zach Wild. My own diary. This is just me live studying, man. Okay, so it goes. this, just watch it, watch some more. Fuck. Might as well just do some more shit while we're here. The more we blab, the more we learn. Like it really means anything. Getting the Malmsteen sound is after you finish your arpeggio. When you do your ascending run, you start off on the same note that you ended your arpeggio in the number three box. Because all you're doing is you're just carrying that note. Carrying the same note. Fuck it. There it is right there. You're just carrying the same note. The same note's just being held. Well, he's still doing the A note there. octave apart. He's still in the same key. I just have him an octave apart. Now, is this the two? This is the two octave lower. Okay, it is two octave lower. All right. Huh. All right. Let's see. Let's look at it again. Let's rewind all of these together. Here's full speed ahead. He's actually doing the E on full speed ahead. He's doing that 3E in the key of C. All right, one octave lower. It's an A in the key of F. A is a sixth note in the key of F. Two octaves lower. There it is. That's the octave lower A. Alright, so that's that. Alright, we got that on the record. Alright, so once again, let's look at old Yngwie go full speed ahead. Full steam ahead here for a little bit. Bring him over here, go full steam ahead there, Yngwie. Now let's look at him do this over and over again. Go turn it on loop.
Chapter 10. Suffering and the End of Suffering. The interconnectedness of all things. Buddhists have always known it, and physicists now confirm it. Nothing that happens is an isolated event. It only appears to be. The more we judge and label it, the more we isolate it. The wholeness of life becomes fragmented through our thinking. Yet the totality of life has brought this event about. It is part of the web of interconnectedness that is the cosmos. This means, whatever is, could not be otherwise. In most cases, we cannot begin to understand what role a seemingly senseless event may have within the totality of the cosmos. But recognizing its inevitability within the vastness of the whole can be the beginning of an inner acceptance of what. Chapter 4. The Now. On the surface, it seems that the present moment is only one of many, many moments. Each day of your life appears to consist of thousands of moments where different things happen. Yet, if you look more deeply, is there not only one moment, ever? Is life ever not this moment? This one moment, now, is the only thing you can never escape from, the one constant factor in your life.
I don't think it was that one. Let's try this one. tender surrender.
Chapter 6. Acceptance and Surrender. Whenever you're able, have a look inside yourself to see whether you're unconsciously creating conflict between the inner and the outer, between your external circumstances at that moment, where you are, who you're with, or what you're doing, and your thoughts and feelings. Can you feel how painful it is to internally stand in opposition to what is? When you recognize this, you also realize that you are now free to give up this futile conflict, this inner state of war. How often each day, if you were to verbalize your inner reality at that moment, would you have to say, "I don't want to be where I am"? What does it feel like when you don't want to be where you are? The traffic jam, your place of work, the airport lounge, the people you're with. It is true, of course, that some places are good places to walk out of. And sometimes that may well be the most appropriate thing for you to do. In many other cases, however, walking out is not an option. In all those cases, the "I don't want to be here" is not only useless, but also dysfunctional. It makes you and others unhappy. It has been said, wherever you go, there you are. In other words, you are here, always. Is it so hard to accept that? Do you really need to mentally label every sense perception and experience? Do you really need to have a reactive like-dislike relationship with life, where you are in almost continuous conflict with situations and people? Or is that just a deep-seated mental habit that can be broken?
You notice that he's talking about exactly what's going on in this video that I was making. Constantly struggling for the words to say. We don't really need to say anything at all.
Not by doing anything, but by allowing this moment to be as it is. The habitual and reactive.
Really, all that we need to do is just watch and observe. Become alert. Just look what's going on and listen.
No strengthens the ego. Yes weakens it. Your form identity, the ego, cannot survive surrender. I have so much to do. Yes, but what is the quality of your doing? Driving to work, speaking to clients, working on the computer, running errands, dealing with the countless things that make up your daily life. How total are you in what you do? Is your doing surrendered or non-surrendered? This is what determines your success in life, not how much effort you make. Effort implies stress and strain, needing to reach a certain point in the future or accomplish a certain result. Can you detect even the slightest element within yourself of not wanting to be doing what you are doing? That is a denial of life, and so a truly successful outcome is not possible. If you can detect this within yourself, can you also drop it and be total in what you do? Doing one thing at a time. This is how one Zen master defined the essence of Zen. Doing one thing at a time means to be total in what you do, to give it your complete attention. This is surrendered action.
So in other words, Mr. Tolley is saying slow the fuck down. He's saying give what you're doing your total attention. So if I have one point that I'm trying to make on my guitar, if I'm trying to find what key I'm in, I need to slow down, look at the neck, look at the notes, at a pace that is relaxed, not be in a hurry, because the hurry is always living in the future, and the future is always wanting to make a point. If we're in a hurry to make our point, then we're missing the relaxation, rejuvenation, refreshment, total peace, total joy of this moment right now that has tranquil words to speak in a relaxed fashion. Not overly slow, but naturally at its own pace, without effort. And that effort can be top speed easily. Because we've trained ourselves to go top speed without blowing up. That's what I'm working on. I keep blowing my fucking self up, man. But goddamn, it feels so good. But that's not what I need. I need to slow down. And I've noticed when I do slow down, I can go top speed without blowing up. I just let things be. Even if it's a mistake, even if it's a move in the wrong direction on the guitar, at particular target note, I should just let it go. Say, hey man, that's the note that wanted to be played right now. Just let it go. Let it be.
Empowered action. Your acceptance of what is takes you to a deeper level where your inner state as well as your sense of self no longer depend on the mind's judgment of good or bad. When you say yes to the isness of life, when you accept this moment as it is, you can feel a sense of spaciousness within you that is deeply peaceful.
Well, I'm going to stop the video for now before we lose it.
On the surface, you may still be happy when it's sunny and not so happy when it's raining. You may be happy at winning $1 million and unhappy at losing all your possessions.